You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up.
It feels weird. It feels weird. I'm even talking right now like I'm live. Like we were just doing this, you know, going through show ideas and having normal conversation, and then you start to present it as if it is something live, and you're like, and we're live here.
And we're here from Trent's basement and Chris Breiler's, wherever he's at.
Your voice changes, you start acting different. Yeah, it's weird. I mean, obviously we're not doing a live show. It's a pre-recorded show. There's no comments here, so there's nothing for us to read or feed off of. It's just you and I, Trent. What do we feel? I mean, does it feel different?
It does. Like, I'm already scrolling over to the comments side over here, and there's just nobody talking to us.
There's nothing. There's nobody to perform for. I'm just reading another thing here about, you know, the MDEN locations closing and the filing for bankruptcy. I'm blown away by this. Like, I understand that, like, I don't know, there's a lot that goes into business other than just like merchandise and selling merchandise. And you know, you got to be able to manage everything and do that whole thing. But I'm like blown away that, you know, if it was during the Hoke eras or something like that, I would, or the Rich Rod era, it would make sense to me. But this is the most successful 3-year stretch, arguably, in the program's history, you know, with the national championship last season. And they're going out of business. I just think it's weird. And, you know, who the hell knows what's going to happen there. But, I mean, Trent, I would imagine, do you buy a lot of stuff from the MDEN?
Not really. Like, I have in the past, but, you know, I usually go to like Fanatics or Rally House or something like that to buy my stuff. But I'm not really in the know with this whole MDEN situation. But when I first heard about it several months ago, I think I texted you about it, and I was like all confused. What? I'm just not sure what happened there, because I thought the MDEN was just a huge retailer for Michigan football and basketball. I don't fully understand as to what happened, as to why they're even closing.
I don't know. I mean, I know it owes the University of Michigan a lot of money, and you know, it closed the 12 Oaks Mall location. I think that was announced in recent days. And then today, another announcement, they're closing stores in Detroit and at the Briarwood Mall here in Ann Arbor. So, I mean, you're part of the problem then, Trent. If you weren't buying merchandise from MDEN, I mean, you are part of the problem. You're part of the issue. It's just weird. It's such the MDEN, I feel like, is, like, you know, like even the on-campus things. Like, I remember when, you know, before I started covering the team and would come to Michigan Stadium as just a fan, or, you know, when we lived in Chicago and we would come back to Ann Arbor for games, or to, you know, to visit family or do various things, like, I had to make a stop at the MDEN, and I knew I was going to drop at least $100 every time I went in there.
You buy two shirts, and you're spending $100.
Exactly, right? One hoodie, and you're over $100. Yeah. But like, if it says Rose Bowl champions on it or whatever, like, I'm happy to do it. So like, yeah, that whole thing is weird to me. I find it to be a little bit sad, and I don't know what the replacement's going to be. I'm not sure what the next step is there, but I just, yeah, that it's such a shocking thing. And obviously news of them, you know, filing for bankruptcy has popped up here over the last few weeks, which is why we're talking about it. So again, here we are. We're not live. No comments to feed off of. I can't thank anybody for being here. It's just, we don't really do this, man. And let me ask you this, because I don't really watch a lot of other shows. I don't really pay attention too much to what other people are doing, but I got to think we're a little bit rare in the fact that most of the time we do a show, every time it's
every
live.
Time, yeah.
Every single time it's live, right? Like, I don't know, like, do other people always do live shows, or are we sort of unique in the fact that every time you see us on the screen, we're doing a live broadcast? I mean, you watch a lot of things. You pay attention way more than I do. Is live the norm, or are we sort of the exception to the rule?
I don't watch a whole lot of like YouTube shows, but like, for example, ESPN. I watch some ESPN shows, and I'm fairly certain all of those are live. However, like Get Up, for example, I like Get Up.
Yeah.
And there's not a whole lot of fan interaction there. So like, I feel, even though technically it's probably live, I don't think people are tuning in to talk with Mike Greenberg. I think they're tuning in because they want to listen to what he has to say and other people have to say. And I mean, I'm on here, so I assume people are probably tuning in, wanting to listen to Trent Knoop, you know.
The numbers are going to be incredible. And speaking of Trent Knoop, I mean, you know, you might be asking yourself, why are these guys not live on a Monday? Well, once again, like, if nothing else, Trent, I hope I've proven that I am willing to adjust and shift my entire life just to accommodate the things you have going on in your life. And so, yeah, I mean, we'll talk about this moving forward, because I think it's going to be an adjustment period as we get into the season schedule. But Mondays, I don't think we're going to be doing a live show on Mondays. It's going to be a pre-recorded show. And, you know, much of what we're going to be doing on Mondays anyway is talking about the game that happened the week before and sort of digesting all of that and chopping it up that way. But so to accommodate for Trent's schedule, Mondays will be a pre-recorded show, and then we'll be back live on Wednesdays to do the fan-led show. We'll be live on Fridays to do game prediction, talk over-unders, and then maybe some other games that are happening around the conference and elsewhere in college football that we think are interesting. But I think this is a good format. Hopefully that this will be a format that works. And that people will be receptive to. And it's still going to be the same old show, same old thing. It's just, you know what I mean? You're not going to be able to come on here and call Trent a dickhead, at least live. You can do it in the comments afterwards, and I'll make sure he reads it. I'll make sure he hears it. Let's just get right into it. We spent, I don't know, about 30 minutes before I hit the record button on this talking about, you know, different things we wanted to go through. And I know it came out, it's been a couple of weeks at this point, but, you know, Michigan number 9 in the preseason AP poll. I don't think anybody, you know, I saw some people online took it as a sign of disrespect. How dare you put the defending national champions at number 9 when, once again, Ohio State near the top, you know, all the usual suspects, Georgia. I mean, let me actually read through it. So Michigan number 9 in the AP poll. Here's the top 10. You've got Georgia number 1, Ohio State number 2, Oregon number 3, Texas number 4. Before we go any further, Ohio State, Oregon, Texas, number 2, number 3, number 4, all on Michigan's schedule, by the way. Alabama, number 5, Ole Miss, number 6, Notre Dame, number 7, Ole Miss, number 6. I was a little bit surprised by that.
A lot of love down there.
How can you not like Lane Kiffin, though? I mean, that guy is such a, he is a lovable guy. I don't really like a lot of coaches outside of whoever's, you know, calling the shots in Ann Arbor, but I've always had like I like Lane Kiffin for whatever reason. I think he's a decent coach. He seems like just a decent guy that you'd want to hang around. So Ole Miss number 6.
I'd drink a cup of coffee with Lane Kiffin, like, if I had the opportunity.
You're not a drinker, right? You wouldn't have
I'm not a drinker, yeah.
Notre Dame number 7, Penn State number 8, Michigan number 9, and Florida State number 10. So, you know, I mean, just looking at the top 10, it goes to show how difficult Michigan's schedule is going to be this upcoming season. But like I said, a lot of people, some people, Michigan fans took it as disrespect. You know, Michigan, they're the defending national champions, 3-time Big Ten champions. They've been in the playoff the last 3 seasons. How do you feel about Michigan's spot at number 9 when you look at some of those other teams that are ahead of them? Do you think that's a fair spot for the Wolverines, or is there a little bit of disrespect there?
You know, without going back and looking at the previous preseason rankings, I can't remember the last time a defending national champion was ranked 9th or lower. But I mean, I feel like it's a pretty good spot to put Michigan in early on. Like, you're losing JJ McCarthy, and that alone I think is huge, because you don't know who's going to play quarterback for Michigan. Every quarterback that has a chance,
we know who's going to play quarterback, Trent. We know who's going to play. Come on.
We assume it's going to be Alex Orji.
No, we know. We're just not at liberty to say.
Oh, okay. Okay.
We know. We know who it is.
We're in the know. We're insiders. But yeah. So whoever starts for Michigan, it's not like they have a ton of college experience. And again, you're replacing a guy that went 27-1 as a starting quarterback for Michigan, won the national championship last season. And then, I mean, that's just the quarterback alone. You're talking about defense replacing a ton of guys while they're bringing back Mason Graham, Kenneth Grant, Will Johnson, so on and so forth. Defense, I don't think, is the issue. I think most people think Michigan's defense is going to be a top 5 defense once again. It's just offensively that I think people are skeptical of. And yeah, I mean, I feel like number 9 is probably a good place to start Michigan at, especially with their schedule too.
Yeah, I mean, I also feel like it's a fair spot, and we've talked about this before, and most people know, like, it doesn't really matter. I mean, you start anywhere in the top 25 and you're in the Big Ten, if you take care of business and win, like you're going to be just fine and squarely in the playoff hunt at the end of the year. So Michigan at number 9, like it's just preseason BS. Like if they win and handle their business on the schedule, they'll be where they need to be. You talk about the loss of JJ McCarthy, but I mean, also lost the entire offensive line, 6 offensive linemen. You lose Blake Corum, you know what I mean? And then even on the defensive side of the ball, we know that they're reloading and that, the expectation is that Michigan's defense is going to be elite, but it's not like they didn't lose guys there too. I mean, Junior Colson and Mike Barrett. I mean, these are guys that were like staples of Mike Sainer still, Chris Jenkins up front. Like there's a lot of talent that Michigan lost. And then let's just add on Jim Harbaugh to the whole thing. You know, Jim Harbaugh and part of the staff is gone. And I think when you factor all of that in, I mean, you said you don't know how many national champions have been ranked outside what? Top five
probably.
I don't know how many have been either, but I would venture to say that none of those previous teams have lost their head coach after winning the national championship. We've talked about that before. You got to go all the way back.
Yeah, we know that it hasn't happened. Yeah.
Yeah, you got to go back to the 90s with Nebraska. Michigan is a bit of it's so weird how much of an unknown they are. And I feel like that's why people are struggling to digest maybe the reason why Michigan isn't thought of higher, because when you take a step back and you look at all of the offseason turnover and changes that occur, like it just doesn't happen in college football. And so I think people look at this Michigan team and you say, yeah, there's pieces there. Sharon Moore was there before. He was an architect of the offense and he had his hands on everything. And it feels like Michigan's going to be in a good spot, but you really don't know what you're going to get out of this team. And so I think number 9 is more than fair. But, there's some people who think Michigan is extremely overrated at number 9, right? And we'll talk about it. Colin Cowherd on his show, he's on Fox Sports, and he talked about Michigan during one of his segments. And Colin Cowherd is a guy who it feels like he's been very friendly, to Michigan and Jim Harbaugh. They had that early dust up, right? Where Jim went on his show and there was like that weird sort of like Colin was asking him questions and Jim was doing what Jim Harbaugh does, give like a 1 or 2 word response. And Colin was like, I feel like we're not getting anywhere here. I'm just trying to pull things out of you. And so they started off a little bit rocky, but Colin Cowherd came around and became, he was a Michigan guy. I mean, he was recently on record telling, people that are like, obsessing over the sign stealing thing to quit whining, folks that are like, Michigan State folks and Ohio State folks and talking about all the issues that they have. So I have been somewhat, I mean, I'm not tuning into his show, but, pro Colin Cowherd, just as I was almost with Paul Feinbaum there for a little while. That ship has sailed. That guy, I'm not going to go off on Paul Feinbaum.
He's just so back and forth right now.
He can't help it. It's so obvious that the guy just wants to. It's like whatever I can say to get the most attention, I'm going to say it. Like that's my deal. That's Paul Feinbaum. But Colin Cowherd recently was talking about Michigan and sort of, the expectation for the Wolverines this year. As we mentioned, they're number 9 in the AP poll. Colin Cowherd, not big on Michigan heading into 2024. In fact, here's what Cowherd had to say about the Wolverines at number 9. He said, and I quote, "I think Michigan is the most overrated in the top 25. They lost not only depth, they lost leaders. They lost locker room leaders, fifth-year seniors. They also lost the best quarterback Harbaugh's had. It's very difficult to lose not only starters, but veteran quality starters who were clubhouse leaders." Most of what he's saying there, I agree with. I think that's difficult. But Trent, to call Michigan the most overrated in the top 25, that seems a little bit out of pocket. No, and I know I only did the top 10, but I mean, would it be helpful for me to go through the top 25 so that we know? I mean, like I said, Ole Miss at number 6, that feels a little bit strange to me. You've got Missouri at number 11, Utah at number 12, Tennessee at number 15, Oklahoma State 17, Miami at 19, which
there's the most overrated team, Miami. They can't seem to win more than 7 games in a season.
Right. Miami is one of those teams where I feel like every year you're like, maybe this is the year. And then it just turns out not being the year for Miami. You got Arizona at number 21, Kansas at 22, Iowa at number 25. That's not going to come as a shock to Trent Noop. I mean, we'll talk about that later in the show. Trent Noop is very high on Iowa, but Trent, Is Michigan the most overrated in the top 25 at number 9?
I mean, I feel like when you get down to like the 20s, like borderline top 25, you really, I don't know that you'd even really consider them overrated at that point in time, potentially underrated, but yeah, we can get into Iowa later. Michigan, number 9, I don't see how you can say they are the most overrated team. I mean, you're literally talking about the defending national champions. Like I just said previously, like I realize you lose a guy like JJ McCarthy, who was the best quarterback in the Jim Harbaugh era, one of the best quarterbacks to probably ever play at Michigan, arguably. You lose Blake Corum, another staple of the Michigan offense the past 4 seasons. You lose the entire offensive line. But the thing with Michigan is they rotated so many guys that you're not talking about a team. For example, every offensive lineman that's going to start this year for Michigan, they have experience. Like, you're not talking about they're throwing in guys who's never played in their lives. You bring in Josh Preeb, Northwestern transfer. He was an all Big Ten player last year, team captain. Miles Hinton, he started at Michigan last season. He started, I think, 5 games for Michigan.
Was it injury? What was the reason why he ended up going out? I mean, I know he was in the starting rotation at one point. Was it production? Was it injury? I know he had some sort of injury last year.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he got injured, and then he just got I think it was Ladarius Henderson that ended up coming in for him, and he just ended up performing really well. Yep. and Hinton became like that number 6-7 lineman on the team. But anyway, yeah, like the line, they all have experience. The only question mark on this team right now is the quarterback. What are you going to get at quarterback? But like we've both talked about, if Alex Orji, Jack Tuttle, whoever, if they can just play up to Cade McNamara standards in 2021, Michigan's going to be a top 10 team again, I believe, because I fully believe their defense is going to be really good. I think their run game is going to be really good again with Donovan Edwards and Khalil Mullings. So no, long story short, I don't think Michigan is the most overrated team.
This is where I feel, well, I don't know that I feel for them because they're all making a lot of money to do what they do. But anybody who covers from a national standpoint, like to me, this was just a very casual take by Colin Coward, because when you look at this team, and you just did it perfectly, Trent, you go through what's going on in the offensive line, and then you talk about guys like Donovan Edwards, and you talk about Colston Loveland, and you talk about what Michigan has at wide receiver. Some of these guys are unknowns, but I don't think Tyler Morris is an unknown. I expect a lot of Frederick Morris. Samaj Morgan obviously had a hell of a freshman campaign. They have weapons on this offense, and then defensively, we really don't need to get into it much at all. We know what Michigan has defensively. And I think that anytime you have an elite defensive unit, that's going to give your team a chance every single Saturday. And so you're right. It really does come down to the quarterback position. I asked you this before. I mean, how different is your outlook on Michigan in 2024 if JJ decides to come back and every other position on the team is the same, right? We're thinking, you know, yeah, they can beat Oregon. They can beat Ohio State. Like, I think people are thinking totally different about this team if JJ McCarthy returns, which goes to show just, I mean, we all know how important the quarterback position is, but it's not like, I think it's a little bit strange in that there wasn't really a solid second guy in place once JJ left, right? There is a bit of a question mark, and nobody really, we have an idea of who we think it's going to be, but even the guy that we think is who it's going to be is a large unknown, right? There's a lot of question marks there. And so I think that it is a bit of a strange place to be just given how successful Michigan has been. We know that, you know, the quarterback, it's not really a prolific position at the University of Michigan. You're not really asked to do a lot. But I also think because of that, I don't know how much of an impact that position is going to have on 2024, where what I mean by that is you don't have to be a superstar. You said it yourself. All you got to do is be Cade McNamara. Yep. If we can have Cade McNamara in 2024, Michigan's going to be just fine because you've got enough weapons around. I think the offensive line is going to be solid. And then obviously defensively, Michigan is going to be elite. And so when you look at that, I mean, you know, you got Penn State right there ahead of them. You got Notre Dame and Ole Miss. I don't know. Like, I could argue that Penn State at 8, Notre Dame at 7, and Ole Miss at number 6, like, all of those teams are far more overrated than Michigan heading into this year. Maybe some fewer question marks there. But even if you've got guys returning, like, we know Penn State has a habit of shitting the bed year in and year out. Like, they haven't had a breakthrough season with James Franklin. Notre Dame, same sort of thing. Like, there's really nothing there to suggest that, oh, this is the year that Notre Dame is finally going to break through. And then same with Ole Miss. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. Ole Miss is a mystery to me. I'm not going to pretend like I know what's really going on with their program. But, I mean, is Ole Miss ever in the playoff picture? Is Ole Miss ever, like, in the championship hunt? They're just not. Like, they're one of those teams that's exciting, right? Yep. Lane Kiffin is good for a soundbite, but they're not.
They lost Quinshon Judkins.
Yeah, right. Correct. To the Buckeyes. The top five, that seems solid to me. You got Alabama, Texas, Oregon, Ohio State, and then Georgia at number one. That makes sense to me. But I would argue that Ole Miss, Notre Dame, Penn State, far more overrated in their ranking at six, seven, and eight than Michigan is at number nine. And then that's not the only thing that Coward said about it. So he said he thinks that they're the most overrated in the top 25. And then how did he finish it out? Let me go down here to the bottom.
I think he said that he wouldn't be shocked if Michigan wasn't even ranked in the top 20.
Yeah, he says, I quote, "Michigan will not be a top 20 team." Overrated. Michigan will not be a top 20 team. Overrated. That's courtesy of Colin Cowherd on his show on Fox Sports. So, So let's do this. So let's transition from that, because Cowherd says Michigan isn't going to be a top 20 team. I feel differently, but I also think that, you know, it's when you look at Michigan's schedule, it is sort of a valid concern. Like, what can Michigan be? Because this schedule, Ohio State, Oregon, Texas, all right there in the top five, and they're all on Michigan's schedule. You actually went through, Trent, and I don't know how you did this. God bless you for doing it. But you went through and you looked at every single Big Ten team, all 18 teams of the Big Ten, by the way, which, before we get into that, should the conference change its name? Should we veer away from Big Ten? Should we go to something? I mean, you know, you've got the SEC, which doesn't, like, there's no definitive number of teams that are there. What are your thoughts on that? This was a topic that I wanted to bring up a few shows ago. We never got to it. Before we get into this, because you did go through all 18, should the Big Ten reconsider, you know, maybe what the name should be? Should you get away from naming a specific amount of teams in the conference?
I mean, when you look at the numbers, obviously you got to think about it. You're at 18 teams. I mean, there for a while, the Big Ten was 12 teams, 14 teams. Now it's at 18 teams. But at the same time, it's one of the most historic conferences out there. When you think of college football, you think of the Big Ten and you think of the SEC. So, I mean, just because of the name history there, I would say no. But yeah, when you look at the numbers, because I'm sure at some point in time, it's going to go from 18 to 20 or maybe even 24 at some point in time.
These
mega conferences really do come to fruition. And then,
There's no way it's done.
I don't think so either.
No, what is that meme from? I forget what the movie is, but he says things are now in motion that cannot be undone. Like, this is where we're at in college football now. And I can't remember which coach recently said it, but he indicated that we're going towards, like, super conferences here, where there's only going to be two conferences in the country. And, you know, each conference is going to have like 20, 30, 40 teams in it. You know what I mean? Like, that's where this is headed. But Trent, I agree with you. The Big Ten, like, when I hear Big Ten, I don't even think 10 teams anymore, because it hasn't been that for so long. To me, like, Big Ten is just a brand, just like Nike is a brand or Doritos is a brand or whatever else. You know what I mean? So, like, I have seen some people say, like, why are we going to keep calling it the Big Ten when there's 18 teams in the conference? I think that, look, with so much changing in college football all of the time and just trying to find a way to keep up and trying to find a way to hold on to that tradition that we all grew up on and that we all love, and maybe this, but you're 30. So you're kind of teetering on the edge of being an old head. Like, I'm there at 40. Just give me something that I can hold on to in college football that won't change from a tradition standpoint.
I'm with you.
And I think the Big Ten, I mean, I like the conference. Hell, how many teams are in the Pac-12 right now?
Two,
right? You can't go to Pac-2. You can't do that. You got to keep it Pac-12. Like, just keep the conference names what they are. Don't change it. It doesn't matter how many teams go in there. Like, when you hear Big Ten, the first thought in your mind isn't 10 teams. It's like, you know, it's Midwest football. It's, you know, it's Buckeyes, Michigan, right. It's like that sort of thing. And so just don't change that name. I would be extremely disappointed. Was happy to see, by the way, when they released the Big Ten maps commercial, right? I know that a lot of people like it, but dude, Big Ten put that out and it got like, I don't know, 40, 50,000 likes on Twitter. Like people were very, very excited to see that commercial come back. And obviously when you hear it on TV, it's just, it's a signal that football is here. Sports is here. It's just, it's the perfect time of year. So we'll put it here on record, Trent and I, and we know, look, we know that the folks at the University of Michigan tune in and listen to us. We know that people at the NCAA tune in and listen, people at the Big Ten tune in and listen. Trent and I are here telling you, do not change the name of the conference. Please, for the love of God, if you're going to change everything else, whatever, do what you got to do. Leave the name alone. Right.
We do not give the okay for the Big Ten or NCAA to change the Big Ten. I repeat, it is not okay.
No, we won't stand for it. We won't allow it to happen. And even if you do change it, I'm still going to call it the Big Ten anyway. So that's how it's going to work. But let's get into, you know, the Big Ten, which again now has 18 teams. All 18 teams Trent went through, looked at their schedule, and sort of predicted where they were going to fall, what the overall record was going to be, where the wins are coming from, where the losses are coming from. I mean, like I said, God bless you, Trent, because you went into detail and you, you know, you sort of mapped out the road for each Big Ten team. And I'll be, you know, I'll say this. I was a little bit surprised on what I saw, particularly in the top five as it relates to one specific team. So how do you want to do this, Trent? I know we talked about it in the pre-show, but I think there's some teams in here that are being slept on, and I think that your overall schedule sort of or your overall record sort of speak to that. But you've got things playing out in a really interesting way within the conference that I think would make for some interesting discussion towards the end of the regular season as far as it relates to the playoff picture. So do you want me to sort of go through here? Maybe I can just list off the records for each team for the people that are listening and not watching, and then we'll talk about it. So let's stop at the bottom. We'll start at the bottom. This is the bottom of the barrel, who Trent thinks will go from worst to first in the Big Ten, according to Trent Noop, over our entire regular season schedule. So at number 18, Trent has Minnesota finishing 1-8 in the conference, 4-8 overall. He's got Purdue finishing at 2-10, 1-8 in the conference. Indiana at 5-7, 2-7 in the conference. Northwestern 4-8, 2-7 in the conference. Michigan State 4-8, 2-7 in the conference. Maryland at 5-7, 2-7 in the conference. UCLA 4-8, 2-7 in the conference. Illinois 5-7, 3-6 in the conference. Nebraska 7-5, 4-5 in the conference. Washington 7-5, 4-5 in the conference. Wisconsin 8-4, 6-3 in the conference. USC 7-5, 6-3 in the conference. Here's where things start to get a little bit interesting. You've got Rutgers at 9-3, 7-2 in the conference. That would be a hell of a year for Rutgers, especially in a loaded Big Ten. And here's where things get really interesting. This is the top five according to Trent Noop. He's got Penn State finishing at 10-2, 7-2 in the conference. He's got Michigan finishing at 10-2, 7-2 in the conference. Can confirm that Trent is a Michigan hater. He's got them losing two games. Trent has Iowa at 11-1. 8-1 within the conference. The Hawkeyes, 11-1, 8-1 within the conference. Ohio State, 11-1, 8-1 within the conference. And then Oregon, 12-0, 9-0 within the conference. So, Trent, you are clear. I mean, once you get to Rutgers, you know, at 9-3, you know, Penn State 10-2, Michigan 10-2, Iowa 11-1, Ohio State 11-1, Oregon 12-0. I guess, where do you want to start with that? You know what I mean?
Pretty loaded.
You're pretty high on some of these teams at the top of the conference, which again, I think is going to create an interesting discussion as it relates to the playoff. But let's talk about something. What about Rutgers, you know, gives you the confidence that this is a 9-3 to a 7-2 team within the conference? I mean, walk me through what goes into that decision.
Well, I mean, when I was going through this, like I told you before we hit record, I was actually going through, I went to Big Ten schedule week one, so on and so forth. And I just kind of chopped up who I thought would win, lose, obviously I took into consideration if they were home or away. But so like Rutgers and Penn State and Iowa, I don't think their schedules are very hard. Like they stay away from the most, they stay away from the top end teams. Like they don't play Michigan, Oregon, and Ohio State all in one season. And that was the big thing for me. I think Rutgers has been one of those scrappy teams for a while. Chris, are you able to pull up Rutgers' schedule real quick? It's not loading on my end.
Yeah, here, let me get it for you. I mean, we have to talk about Rutgers.
Yeah.
At 9-3, I just, you know, a little bit surprised by that. So you've got for Rutgers, you've got wins against Howard, Akron, Washington, Nebraska, UCLA, Minnesota, Maryland, Illinois, and Michigan State. So those are the 9 wins for Rutgers. You've got them losing to Virginia Tech, Wisconsin, and USC.
So once again, they don't play Michigan, they don't play Oregon, they don't play Ohio State, and they don't play Penn State. So you're talking about
the and four they get Washington at home.
And they get Washington at home, which I predicted a loss there. But yeah, they don't play a very tough schedule. And I think that Rutgers has been one of those scrappy teams. They have that running back. He returns, Kyle Manungai, I think is his name. He was a leading rusher in the Big Ten. They always play pretty good defense under Greg Schiano. I just feel like this could be the year that Rutgers really elevates its game in the Big Ten.
I mean, when you look at the schedule, I mean, you can certainly see a pathway to 9 wins for Rutgers. And you're right. You know, you don't have to play Michigan. You don't have to play Ohio State. You get to avoid some of the, you know, the big dog. You don't play in Oregon. So, I mean, that anytime you can avoid Michigan, Ohio State, Oregon in the Big Ten, like that's going to set you up for some level of success. And you're right. Rutgers has proven the ability to be, you know, a scrappy team under Greg Schiano. I mean, it seems like they're disciplined. They play hard. And you know, when you look at Rutgers, they're sort of this, they're one of those teams where like, they've never felt like a Big Ten team to me. You know what I mean? Same right. With Maryland. Like it's one of those are two programs that I don't ever envision having an elite level of success within the conference, because I just don't know how programs like that are going to compete with the likes of an Oregon or an Ohio State or a Michigan or even a Penn State. And so those teams really don't feel like a Big Ten team to me, but certainly when you lay it out that way, I can see Rutgers getting to 9 wins. Now, I think where it gets really interesting, at least according to the way you see this playing out, is you've got 5 teams in the Big Ten Conference that you're predicting will have a 10-2 or better record, right? And just to reiterate, you've got Penn State at 10-2, Michigan at 10-2, Iowa at 11-1, Ohio State at 11-1, and Oregon at 12-0. Trent, if there are 5 teams in the Big Ten that finish with 10-2 records or better in the conference, what do you think that means for a playoff picture? Because unless all 5 get in, that means you've got a 10-2 team in the Big Ten conference being left out of a 12-team playoff. Seems hard to imagine, but how do you see that playing out at the end of the year?
I mean, obviously, it would all depend on how the SEC performs, how the ACC performs, how the Big 12 performs, and so on and so forth. However, I don't see 5 teams getting in from one conference. I think 4 is probably the max. So in my scenario, I think Penn State would be the team out because Iowa only has 1 loss. Michigan's schedule is much, much more difficult than Penn State's schedule.
Yeah.
And when you look at the strength of schedule, I think that's what the committee would look at. While it'd be very difficult to leave a 10-2 team out of a 12-team playoff, I just don't see 5 Big Ten teams getting in. So just the way I have it all shaping up, I think Penn State would be the team left out.
Yeah, and I think you're right about Michigan and with their schedule. I mean, if Michigan goes 10-2, keep in mind the 5 games on Michigan's schedule that you need to watch out for: Texas in week 2, they open Big Ten play at home against USC, and then you go on the road to Washington, you play Oregon, and then you're at Ohio State. So those 5 games, that means Michigan's putting together a 3-2 record in those 5 games: Texas, USC, at Washington, Oregon, and at Ohio State. And I think if Michigan can go 3-2 in that stretch, that to me is pretty incredible and certainly is going to be a great thing to have on your resume. And I think that points to what you're saying. Like when you look at Penn State's schedule, like they don't have quite the difficult path that Michigan does to getting there. So if both teams finish at 10-2, the committee is going to look at Michigan's schedule, and there's going to be, I mean, whether the wins against Texas or USC or on the road at Washington or Oregon, Ohio State, again, you pull three wins out of there, like Michigan is going to have to pull off some upsets to get to 10-2 this year. And if they can do that, certainly see a scenario where, yeah, Penn State gets left out at 10-2. And then it's like deja vu for James Franklin. You know what I mean? Like, he can put together, you know, 8, 9, 10 win seasons. He just can't get Penn State to break through, right? And that seems to be what the story was like for Michigan under Jim Harbaugh for so long, right? That, yeah, Michigan could go out and win 10 games, but you couldn't beat Ohio State and you couldn't get to the Big Ten championship. And, dude, you know, this is another thing that you and I have talked about. And when you look at sort of how these things are going to play out, like, I'm asking you about the top five as it pertains to what the college football playoff picture is going to look like. I'm not even bringing up the Big Ten championship because, to me, I don't really place too much value. Like, if you can get there, great. If you can win it, awesome. But in a team or in a conference with 18 teams in a loaded conference, to me, the Big Ten championship is like icing on the cake, right? Like, it would be great to do it, but overall, you want to get in the 12-team playoff and you want to have a chance to play for a national championship. And so certainly, yes, I agree with you. If Michigan's 10-2 and Penn State's 10-2, and when you look at both of their records, there's no doubt that Michigan's going to be the beneficiary there, and that a 10-2 Michigan team with that schedule is getting into the college football playoff, right? We're in agreement on that. Talk me through Iowa at 11-1, because, you know, I don't know. We talked about all you got to do is beat Cade McNamara earlier in the show. I'm not so sure that Cade McNamara is going to start for Iowa this fall based on some of the reports coming out of camp. But you got Iowa at 11-1. When I first looked at this, Trent, I was like, that is egregious. That's unbelievable. How can Trent be so high on the Hawkeyes when it's proven that they barely know how to score a point in college football? But then I looked at the schedule. So walk me through what the line of thinking here is at Iowa at 11-1.
So before I get into the schedule, let's just talk about Iowa real quick. Iowa is a team that has elite defense. They've been a top five, top 10 defense for several years now. They lost Cooper DeJean, but they're going to have a really, really good defense once again in 2024. They had the worst offense last year in college football. Like, literally the worst offense.
And let's keep in mind, it was right after Cade McNamara came out in the preseason and said, please keep saying we're going to have the shittiest offense. Please keep saying we're going to have the worst offense. And then they went out and did it. Just an incredible sequence of events there. But yes, Trent, go on. The worst offense in college football.
I'm banking on whether it is Cade McNamara or the Northwestern transfer, Brendan Sullivan. Their offense has to get better. I mean, they hired Tim Lester from Western Michigan. They had a good offense under him. I'm banking on Iowa to have at least a top 60 offense is what I'm thinking. So if they do, even top 70.
What an improvement that would be. I mean, you know, you get into the top 60 from being dead last. That would be an improvement.
They had one of the worst passing games in all of football. I think their rushing attack was decent enough, but teams just stacked the box because they knew they couldn't pass the ball. And then if you have a healthy Cade McNamara, while I know reports have not been high on him, but you have a healthy Cade McNamara or a Brendan Sullivan that's a dual threat quarterback, I think you can make the offense at least score maybe 20 points a game. And then that's where the schedule comes into play. Once again, they don't play Michigan. They don't play Oregon. Their toughest games at Ohio State, which I have them losing to. But then you're talking about they have Washington at home. They have Wisconsin at home, who hasn't been Wisconsin that we're used to seeing lately. And they have Nebraska at home. Those are their top teams on the schedule.
Yeah.
And they get them at home. You got Wisconsin at home. Iowa's a tough place to win at. You have Nebraska at home. Again, Iowa's a tough place to play at. And I what did Iowa win last year? They won, what, 9 games? And they got to the Big Ten championship against Michigan where they lost? Think about that. They had the worst offense.
Yeah, which is further evidence, though, that the Big Ten absolutely had to get rid of divisions. Now, I do think that adding in these four teams, you could have realigned the divisions somehow. But, yeah, certainly, I mean, Iowa, you know, goes in, represents the Big Ten West in the conference championship game and loses 26-0 and gets absolutely dominated by Michigan. But, yeah, I mean, you're right. And I think where some of these games are being played certainly plays a factor into what the, you know, your overall assessment is. Because yeah, I've been out to Iowa City. I've been to Kinnick, right? I mean, you're driving through cornfields and now for Nebraska, this is nothing new, but like, you know, you're a visiting team. What, you're Washington and you got to go to Kinnick. You know, you pull up and there are, you know, drunk farmers partying on tractors, and it's a weird environment to be in. And then you get into the stadium and, you know, everything you've heard about Kinnick is true. I mean, it's loud, it's raucous. The fans are really close to the field. You know what I mean? We're like at the Big House, the fans are sort of pushed back off of the field and they're up a little bit higher. There's a big wall there. Not the case at Kinnick, man. Like, it's like the fans are right there. And so it is a difficult place to play. We know that Kinnick is notoriously one of the most toughest places to play in all of college football. And yeah, certainly a win against Illinois State, Iowa State, Troy, Minnesota, Washington, Michigan State, Northwestern, Wisconsin, UCLA, Maryland, Nebraska. I think it's when you go through that, it's certainly, and then when you look at where some of those games are being played, again, Wisconsin's got to go to Kinnick, Washington's got to go to Kinnick, it starts to make sense. Okay, yeah, there's a very real scenario where This is the most Iowa thing ever. Iowa can get to 11 wins in the regular season and not have to score more than 13 points in a game in order to do it, right? Like, that's Iowa football, and that's what we could see play out. And so Iowa at 11-1, 8-1 in the conference overall, you know, that might seem like a crazy thing. But again, you know, Trent put it out here. He laid out the schedule. You go in and you look at that schedule, and it seems like very realistic that we could see the Hawkeyes at 11-1. And then, you know, you've got a difficult Iowa team right there in the playoff hunt. And, you know, who knows how things are going to shake out and what the rankings are going to be. But there might be a team, you know, from the SEC that has to come up and play, you know, the Hawkeyes at Kinnick in December. Not an easy place to play in general, but a playoff game at Kinnick in December, yeah, like that would be a nightmare, especially if you're coming from warm weather, which again, is another reason why this football season, man, I just cannot wait for it. I can't wait to see how this plays out. The on-campus first-round playoff games, I am just beyond excited for. So above Iowa, you've got, you know, you're in lockstep with all the other analysts out there in college football, basically picking Ohio State and Oregon. I'm guessing Ohio State at 11-1 and Oregon, you've got a rematch of those two teams from the regular season in the Big Ten championship game. You know, walk me through that a little bit. You think Oregon's going to come into this conference and in year one in a difficult Big Ten, playing some difficult opponents, that Oregon's just going to, they're going to clear the board 12-0 regular season. I struggle with that a little bit.
I do too, but as much as I hate to say it, I'm actually a real big Dan Lanning fan. I think he's a really good coach.
Oh, God, what can I use on my board here? I've got nothing on my board to combat what you just said.
You don't like Dan Lanning?
He seems
like a player's coach.
I think it's I think Oregon just annoys me more than anything, you know, and we were warned from other fan bases around the country. Like, even some Oregon fans themselves were like, we're insufferable. We are a difficult bunch to deal with. And then you've got the damn duck showing up at all the stadiums, and you know, they go down to Indy and they put a giant inflatable duck on the river down there in Indianapolis. That's about the size of a apartment complex floating around. Like, I just feel like Oregon is the definition of all sizzle. What is that saying? Is it like, I'm not a steak eater, so like, I don't know, like sizzle and steak, whatever. There's no sizzle to the steak. It's all sizzle, no steak. However the hell it is you say it, there's just not a lot of substance there to Oregon. I think that they're always a pretty good team, but also they're a team. I mean, when's the last time Oregon won a national championship, Trent?
I mean, yeah, that's fair.
You know what I mean?
I think my thing with Oregon is, I think it revolves around Dylan Gabriel. I think he's a much better quarterback than Bo Nix. And I saw what Bo Nix did in Oregon system. I mean, it made him look like he was a top five quarterback in college football. Yeah. I don't think Bo Nix is a bad quarterback. He might end up having a decent NFL career. I don't think he's as good as Dylan Gabriel. And I think he's going to light it up in that offense. They have two electric receivers, Tez Johnson and Evan Stewart from Texas A&M. They have a really, really good running back in Jordan Jordan James, I think is his name. And defense isn't bad at all. So I think Oregon has the whole package.
Their offensive line is also expected to be very good. So, I mean, to your point, like it seems like this team in much the same way that Ohio State went out and supplemented and built up the roster. Yep. Like they, those are two teams that you can tell they put all the chips on the table and said, we're coming for a national championship this year. Bold strategy for Oregon being the first year in a new conference. And I'll say this, Trent, like, dude, that's a nightmare scenario for me. I don't know how you have it playing out. I don't know if this is the time where you want to talk about it, but you've obviously got Oregon, Ohio State playing for the conference championship. I mean, care to tell us how you see that one playing out since you've went and laid out the entire season for us?
I'm kind of a firm believer it's tough to beat a good team twice. So with that being said, I have Oregon beating Ohio State in the regular season. I would probably lean towards Ohio State beating Oregon the second time around. It's not like Michigan playing Iowa, you know. It's not that Iowa was a terrible team, but they're not an elite team. And I think Ohio State and Oregon are both going to be really, really good in 2024. And I don't see Oregon, I don't think Oregon's that much better than Ohio State where they could go in and beat them twice.
Yeah, I mean, it is a tough thing to do to beat a team twice in the same season, especially in college football. But you know who's got plenty of experience with that? Dan Lanning. We saw that happen last year when he lost to Washington twice. Yep. And then Michigan got up against Washington. And what happened? They beat the shit out of the Huskies. Easy win in the national championship game. And they did that because their defense was just elite, which we think Michigan is going to have that again. No knock on the Michigan offense whatsoever, but the difference maker for Michigan and some of these other teams has been defense, right? Yep. It's hard to score points against the Michigan Wolverines. And I think that that's going to continue to be the case. Let's talk about that. So now we've gone through, you know, you've told us about Iowa and Penn State, and, you know, we haven't really gotten into Ohio State that much, but they're somewhat irrelevant in this, but you've got, you know, the Buckeyes winning the Big Ten championship. You think Oregon's going to run the table in their first year in the Big Ten conference. You've got Michigan sitting there at 10-2. And when I look at how you've positioned this, you know, I think most Michigan fans would be okay with this, right? It's not an ideal scenario, but it's one that gets you in the playoff, right? It gives you a chance to win a national championship. So you've got Michigan at 10-2. The win's coming against Fresno State, against Texas in week two. I'm telling you, dude, if Texas wins that game week two, the hype train for the Wolverines, I mean, you know, put Alex Orji in the Heisman race. These guys are, you know, everybody was wrong about Michigan. Like that week two game for me against Texas, and I've said this to you before, but it's really going to be the fork in the road, I believe, for how this Michigan season plays out. I think if you drop that week two game against Texas, you know how fans are going to react. You're probably not going to get a lot of good quarterback play if that's the case. There's going to be some issues, and people are going to be questioning what Michigan is and what they're not. And then you don't have much time. You've got Arkansas State, and then you jump right back into it with USC, and now you're into the Big Ten Conference schedule. You've got Washington. You've got Oregon. You've got Ohio State. You lose that Texas game, the margin for error for the remainder of the season, if you want to be in the playoff, is essentially zero, right? You can't afford to lose.
All the pressure's on Michigan.
Correct. So when we look at Michigan here, that Texas game, even though it's an out-of-conference game, in the grand scheme of things, when you look at the playoff picture, if you go from 10-2 to potentially 9-3, now things become way more difficult in terms of you trying to get into the playoffs, especially if you've got Penn State finishing at 10-2. Now you're out. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and you've got a potential loss to Ohio State on the schedule. You're not in the conference championship game, and you're not in the college football playoff at 9-3. I think that's a nightmare scenario for Michigan. But under your scenario at 10-2, Michigan is a playoff team. So again, wins against Fresno State, that week two win against Texas would be massive. Arkansas State, USC, Minnesota, Washington, Illinois, Michigan State, Indiana, Northwestern. Those are the 10 wins you've got for Michigan. And then losses are coming against the two most difficult teams on the schedule, one of which is in Ann Arbor. You've got losses against Oregon and then at Ohio State. Are you giving Michigan any chance in that Oregon game whatsoever? I mean, the Wolverines have the second longest active winning streak in all of college football, right? I think it's like 18 straight games. They haven't lost a game in Ann Arbor since, what, the 2020 season? So, you know, you look at this schedule, Oregon's going to have to come into the big house and do what nobody's been able to do over the last 3 years. How close do you see that game being, or is just Oregon head and shoulders above where Michigan is at right now?
I look for it to be a close game. I don't think Oregon's going to come in and blow Michigan out. I just think offensively, Oregon's going to have enough pieces where it can score more points than Michigan to win the game. But I don't think that they're going to come in and win 35-7 or anything like that. I think that it's going to be a close game. Like, I could see like a 31-28 scenario where Oregon comes in, it's a great game, but they pull it out. And I've yet to do this.
Is Oregon, but anybody, is anybody going to be able to score 31 points on the Michigan? I mean, you're talking Mason Graham and Kenneth Grant and Derek Moore and Josiah Stewart and Jay Sean Barham and Ernest Hausman and Will Johnson and, you know, Jair Hill on the other side, Makari Page back there. Like, who's going to score 31? I'll put it this way. I do agree. If there's a team to do it,
that's what I was going to say.
I would lean more towards Oregon.
Yeah, and maybe they don't score 31. You know, maybe it's like a 21-17 type of game. But I think if anybody's going to come in and score more than 30, it's definitely going to be Oregon. I've yet to do this, but I plan on putting out an article of ranking the toughest games on Michigan's schedule from 12-1. And I think Oregon's a more difficult game than Ohio State. Like, I would put more stock into Michigan going into Columbus and winning that game over beating Oregon at home. I'm just very high on what Oregon has this year.
Yeah, I 100% agree with that. And look, it's not even though with the rivalry, like, it's fun to shit on, you know.
You know, like, I like to know where Lou Holtz is right now.
It's fun to make fun of Ohio State, right? We enjoy it. There's a rivalry there. But the reality is, I also, you know, can look at it from the standpoint of, I expect Ohio State to be good this year. And I don't think it's going to be a scenario where Michigan goes in and beats the shit out of them once again, where it's like a 20 plus point victory for Michigan. I think that, you know, Ohio State's going to be favored in that game for a reason. They have loaded up during the offseason. This is going to be, and I asked you about this, where would a win over Ohio State on the road in 2024 fit over the last, you know, you would have to rank them over the last four meetings. And it's not going to pass the 2021 game. I think that one is sort of where the rivalry changed. To me, it wouldn't pass 2022 because Michigan then backed that up by going into the Horseshoe, a place where they hadn't won in 20 years and absolutely dominated Ohio State. That was an incredible game. But it would be third on the list for me under those two wins. And I think that when you look at the way this offseason has played out, we talked about it earlier in the show, Michigan loses their head coach, you lose J.J. McCarthy, you lose Blake Corum, you lose key pieces of the offense and the defense, and combine that with what Ohio State has done during the offseason. If Michigan can go back in there and get another win, their fourth straight, almost every show, they'll set fire to Columbus and they'll be booting Ryan Day's ass out with, like, a guy who has an incredible overall record. But at that point, it will just be, you know, you can't beat Michigan. That's four straight losses. You can't do that as Ohio State's head coach. You got to go, sort of thing. And so, but to your point, I 100% agree. I just think Michigan matches up better with Ohio State. To me, yeah, I know Ohio State has tried to be a little more flashy and be a little more like the Ferrari type, but, you know, this is a game of toughness when those two teams get together. And I think it's just going to be a battle between two hard-nosed programs. Oregon is a little bit of a different story. They like to play faster. They like to play quicker. I think it's going to challenge Michigan in ways that maybe they haven't been challenged in a little while. But keep in mind, a lot of people were saying that about Washington last year, right? It was like, well, wait till Michigan plays Penn State, then we'll see. Okay, we saw what happened. Wait till Michigan plays Ohio State, then we'll see. We saw what happened. Well, wait till Michigan plays Alabama. Yeah. We saw what happened. And then, wait till Michigan faces Michael Penix Jr. in that Washington offense, high octane, Pac-12, they can't hang with it. We saw what happened. They hung with it just fine and won a national championship. So I guess what I've learned through all of that, Trent, is it's easy to get caught up in what some of these other teams are doing and how flashy they are and how high paced it is and all this other stuff. But, like, I think counting out the Michigan Wolverines is a huge mistake. They are built a program that is built on toughness, physicality, mental toughness. And even though a lot of big names have gone during this offseason, what's made them so successful over the last 3 years still remains. And primarily you look at the defensive side of the ball, and that's where they really go on to make life difficult. It's that Joel Klatt analogy of it's a boa constrictor. Mm-hmm. They're not trying to be flashy. They'll run it 30 straight times against you, and they're perfectly fine. You know, we'll play field position. We'll punt the ball. You know, we're not having to score 40 points a game. We'll do it if we need to, but that's not Michigan's approach. So overall, Trent, when I look at the schedule and the way that you put it out and how these teams are going to finish, 10-2 with a loss to Ohio State and Oregon, but in the playoffs, I think Michigan fans can accept that. We'll see what that means in the playoff picture, but I think if that's the way it plays out, and let's say Michigan doesn't ultimately win another national championship, but they 10-2 playoff appearance, I think Michigan fans would accept that. How do you think that that would be received? Let's say it plays out the way you've got it in your article, 10-2, you lose to Oregon, you lose to Ohio State, but you are in the playoff. Regardless of what happens from there on out, most Michigan fans would take that, I'm assuming?
I mean, obviously, you never want to lose to Ohio State, and I think most Michigan fans would come out and say, well, that's not a successful season because you don't beat Ohio State. But at the same time, I think to themselves, they're like, okay, but we're in the playoff. Like, Michigan just got to the playoff. Michigan has a chance to repeat as a national champion. And obviously that's the ultimate goal. Like when the season starts, you want to win the national championship. I get that you have other goals too. You want to beat your rivals. You want to win the Big Ten, but the ultimate goal is to win the national championship. And in this scenario, Michigan loses to Ohio State, but it's in the playoff and maybe they get a chance to rematch with Ohio State and win. Like that's a very realistic scenario.
Right. And we've talked about this before, Trent, but a playoff win over Ohio State versus a regular win over Ohio State.
So much more.
You take the playoff win any day of the week. And yep. It's the same thing with the Big Ten championship, right? Let's just say it was Michigan, Ohio State in the Big Ten championship and Ohio State wins that game, right? But the two teams meet in the playoff again. You're going to take the playoff win over Ohio State over a conference championship win over Ohio State. So that goes back to the conversation of like, devaluing, you know, that regular season game, unless schedules are such a way where like you have to win it to put yourself in a certain position, like it carries so much less weight. But the overall point being that, yeah, if you're 10-2 and you lose to Ohio State, there's a chance you're going to see the Buckeyes again in the playoffs. And if you take care of business, what in the hell do we got going on over there, Trent? My God. Oh, Jesus. I'm right here trying to make a point, and Trent's, you know, he's like Ace Ventura over here. He's got animals crawling all over his desk. But yeah, a playoff win over Ohio State or even a shot at being able to play the Buckeyes again in the playoff, I think that's ultimately where you want to be. The college game has made the transition to like a pro team. You know, you win the division, great, awesome, right? But the ultimate goal is you want to win the Super Bowl, right? That's what the NFL is all about, is winning a Super Bowl. And I think that's where we're at with college football now, right? You want to win the national championship. The other stuff is good. The other stuff is great. But if you can get yourself into the playoff and you can make a run at the national championship / Super Bowl, that's where you want to be as a team. And I think that that's what's going to make this year so much more interesting, is that now you have more teams that have an opportunity to be in this thing. And, you know, with the campus site, first round playoff games, the no divisions, Trent's got 5 teams in the conference with 10 wins or better. Like if it goes that way, this is going to be one hell of a exciting, 2024 season. It's going to be historic in a lot of ways, man. And we're going to be able to witness it firsthand. And so, and look, we're 57 minutes. I think that was a very efficient show. We didn't have any dialogue coming in from fans in the comments because there are no fans here. We're doing the pre-recorded show. I don't think that was a bad one for our first pre-record, Trent. So, you know, again, we're going to continue to do this. I think on Mondays, this is going to be the approach for us. We're going to do a pre-recorded show. We will release it at 6 p.m. But as the season goes on, it's just going to be Trent and I talking about what happened over the weekend and sharing our thoughts about the game. So you'll still get the Monday show, again, released at 6 p.m. And then Wednesday, we're live for Fan-Led Wednesday. Friday, we're doing our game picks, and that'll be another live show on Facebook and YouTube. So you'll be able to tune in there. But it's coming, man. We've got one more week, you know, before game week gets here. And then it's balls to the wall for like the next 4 or 5 months or however long Michigan can continue playing football into the month of January. And I'm really excited about it. Excited to be covering it with you again, Trent, here in what's become just a whirlwind of opportunities and change. Yeah. And but it's great, and I wouldn't have it any other way. As always, appreciate your work. Appreciate anybody who watches this. Once we actually post it, put your comments in the comment section, and we will see you on Wednesday. Appreciate it. Yep.
Thanks, everybody. I know it's probably a little bit of a change, but I think it'll all work out.
It's Trent's fault.
Sorry, Matt Kirby. Your stomach is sick, and it's all in my head, but she's touching his chest now.